Hi everyone, and welcome back to Level 2 of Lesson 7. We just got done talking about Excel tables. These tables are great for working with small amounts of data or to create lookup tables for our lookup functions like VLOOKUP and HLOOKUP. They also prevent us from ruining the integrity of our data by accidentally inserting data like this or sorting columns like this. We talked about that in our previous video. In any business, data is collected on a regular basis. Often, the key to a business's success is its ability to manage and organize this data into a usable format. A database is a set of interrelated data that's stored in tables. In a database, a table is a collection of fields that describes one specific concept, sometimes called an entity. For example, one table might store data about a company's products, and another table might store information about its employees, and another one might store information about which employee sold which product. So there's a separate concept in every different table. Within a table, a field is a single characteristic of that entity, such as a product ID number, or an address, or a total sales amount, or how many products were included on an order, or something like that. A set of fields that describes one product or person is called a record. You might think of it as a row, but us database snobs, we call it a record, so go with it. A database is defined, created, and updated in what's referred to as a database management system, or DBMS, which is a software program that creates and accesses the data in a database. There are a number of different DBMSs out there. You may be familiar with a very simple one called Access. It's Microsoft's Tinkertoy DBMS, and it works okay if there are only a couple of users or for small amounts of data, maybe a couple million rows or so. Its big brother in the Microsoft family is called SQL Server, or more commonly referred to as SQL Server, and it's much more common in the business world. Some other popular DBMSs are Oracle or MySQL. DBMSs impose a great deal of structure on a data set and have a whole bunch of rules designed to keep the data consistent and correct. This structure makes it possible to find specific data very easily, but it can make analysis more difficult. At any rate, it's commonly stored in databases, and then when managers or other system users need snapshot of the data to work on or analyze in any way, they'll typically export the data out of the database that they need into Excel, so that they can then easily analyze it in order to make their day-to-day decisions or make charts out of it and use it for whatever other reason they might have. Either way, we need to show you how to get the data out of the database and into Excel so that we can perform our magic on it that we now have in our tool bag. Let me open up this Access database here that the book uses. Double-click on it, and if we have Microsoft Access on our machine, it opens up this file. And see that over here we have one table? This isn't much of a database, but it works for our purposes for this course, since all we want to show you is how to get our data out of here into Excel. I'll close it, and let's show you how to get it into Excel. We'll start by going up to the data ribbon, and we see that they have a link up here to import from Access, but we can also see that up in this Get External Data section, we can also get data from the web, from text files, like we played around with in the previous Lesson 7 videos. Or under this icon, we see ways to connect to just about every type of database or data source out on the market today. Since we're just wanting to import data from Access, I'll just go back over to here and click. We need to locate the Access database file, so let me maneuver over to it on this remote drive, and after I find it, I'll just double-click on it. If we had more than one table in our database, which is almost always the case, we would be asked here which table we want to import. But since this sample database only has one table, we get to skip that step, and I'm immediately asked how and where I want to place it in my spreadsheet. Since a database is a set of related records placed into a table or tables that may themselves be interrelated, it makes sense that I'll want to import it as an Excel table so that I can take advantage of the features in that structure that we learned about. I'll place that table into the existing worksheet in cell A1, so that all looks good. Let's take a minute to look at the data that got imported to get a feel for it and see what it's capable of telling us. It looks like we have 1,993 rows, or records, in this new table, Each record contains all of this customer and purchase-related information organized into columns, or in databases, they're called fields. For each customer record, we have their address and phone number, along with the dates of their first and last order with us. It also includes the number or count of orders and the total amount of what we've sold them in these fields out here. So this is how we import an entire table. What if we only want a subset of this data? We want to ask the database a question such as, who are my customers in California that have made purchases in the last year? Anytime we want to ask questions of the data in a database, it's commonly referred to as a query. So in order for us to ask this question, we need to use a handy wizard that's built into Excel that will build our query for us. Let me create another sheet and call it Recent CA Customers. Now instead of going to the Access Query Wizard, which imports complete tables, I'll go over here to From Other Sources, and then From Microsoft Query. Let me find the Access Database file here. Here it is on this drive, so I'll select it, and I see the one table in here as well. This step lets me determine which fields to import from this table. If I want them all, I can click on this arrow, and now all of the fields from that table are over here. Let's say for some reason that I don't want the phone numbers. I'll select phone numbers and then click on this arrow to move it back over here to the left pane. To continue working on my query, I'll click Next, and now I get the opportunity to refine my question of the data. I remember that I only want the California customers, so I'll select State, and then in this field, select Equals, and then in this field, the wizard thankfully displays all of the values included in the database, so for that field, I'll click on CA for California. The next part of my question was to limit the customers to the ones that have ordered products in the last year. To do this, I'll click on the last order date field, and then select greater than, and then I'll put a date in this format from 1 year ago, 2014-07-17, and I'll click on and here, and then add the criteria of less than, 2015-07-17, which is today. I click on Next, and then I can add some sorting criteria. I want to sort them all by city, and then by company name, and hit Next. Here I can save my query if I find myself wanting to run the same query every once in a while. I'll call it Ken's Awesome Query, and then run it. We see that our data is imported. Now, instead of the 1,993 customers, we have 641 customers in California. And I'll look here, check my dates. They look like they're all within my requested range, so all seems to have worked. Just an FYI, if I wanted to run that query again of the data, then I could go back up here to existing connections in this workbook. And there's my awesome query that I could run again if I wanted to. Now that we have the data imported, we can perform some of our wonderful calculations on it. But before we do that, we need to discuss dates and times for a minute. In this data, we have the first order date and the last order date columns. When we imported them, the wizard automatically formatted them as dates and times. If we look over here in our formula bar, we can see the date with the full time displayed. The way Excel works with dates can be a bit confusing though, even more so for time. Excel stores every date as a number, and that number corresponds to the number of days since the start of the year 1900. Let me show you over here. If I put in a number of 1 here, and then in the adjacent cell I'm going to create a formula equal to that cell, we get the number 1 here as well. Now let me format that new cell as a date and time. And we see here that we get 1/1/00 and 12 a.m. Now those zeros could be 1900 or 2000. So just to show off a little custom formatting so that we can see the 1900 or 2000, I'll come down here, right click on it, customize the format that goes back into that cell. Right up here where there's two Y's, I'll add another two Y's so that there's four Y's there. Hit enter, voila, we now have a four-digit year. Let me add some other numbers here. 2, 3, 100, 1,000, 10,000. Now I'll copy that formula cell down and see what we get. Each of these dates corresponds to the number of days since the turn of the century at 1900. So enough with dates. Let me show you how Excel works with times. We just learned that Excel shows each date as the number of days since the beginning of 1900, right? Within each day, we put a number to the right of the decimal point, like 0.5, so this number is 2.5, right? Well, that decimal means how much of the day are we past midnight? 0.5 means 0.5 days, which is 12 hours. So now this date shows 12 p.m. on the second day of the year. If I change it to 2.25, 2 1/4 days since the beginning of that century, so that's 6 a.m., 2.99 is 11:45 p.m., etc. Handling dates and times in the form of decimals allows us a lot of flexibility in working with dates and times. For instance, if I want to add 10 days to this date, I can just add 10 to this number, and let's see what it is now. January 11th, 1900. Additionally, Excel has several date-related formulas. The first one is the today function. If we want a cell to always contain today's date, we can go to that cell and type in equals today, and then a pair of parentheses. We now have today in that cell, and it will change every day to show you today's date. So if you open it tomorrow, it'll update to tomorrow's date then. As a side note, if you ever needed yesterday's date, you could just subtract 1 from this function like this. Also, another handy hint, if you ever want to put in today's date into a cell, then there's a keyboard shortcut of Control semicolon. Note that this is just a static date that will not ever change like the today function does. And if you want the current time, you can do a Control Shift semicolon and get the correct time. Now that we're awesome on our dates, let's add some functionality to this table that wasn't included in the raw data extracted out of the database. We quite often have to do this since databases may not contain all of the data that we need. Sometimes you have to calculate it. If we go to the first top cell adjacent to our table and type in our header, days since last sale, note that the table automatically expands to this new column. If I want the number of days since the last sale, all I have to do is start my formula here in the top row with equals today minus this cell here. And ta-da! Also notice that when we're working in a table, Excel quite often copies that formula down to the end of the table for you whenever it can. To show you another handy formula, let's add another column here called relationship in years. For this group of customers, I want to see how long in years they've been our valued customers. Let's look at this formula here, equals year frac. This formula returns the year fraction representing the number of whole days between two dates. The first parameter needed is the start date, so I'll select the cell in the first order date column, and then for the end date, I'll just put in today. Next is this obscure list of ways that we can calculate our years. Not all months have the same number of days in them, and not all years have the same number of days due to leap year. So we have all of these different choices here that will allow us to take these into account. For instance, if we wanted to compare the sales in February with 28 days in it, with sales in March, which has 31 days in it, we could use one of these other choices that assumes that every month has 30 days in it. Here's a handy URL that gives you a better description of this logic than in the book or as I just went over. Since I'm not comparing financial calculations and just want actual fractions of a year, then I'll just choose 1 for our basis parameter. And there you go. Now there are many other date functions that are summarized in a table in the back of Level 2 of our book, so please take a look at these as you'll probably have to work with some of them in the future. See you in the next video.